Should hit record. Find the constant shop and place it down. It's called the constant shop. And what the constant does is it literally, you can set a value. It's just a constant value. And now we need something that increases by the value that it, you give it as in the constant. So it's kind of like a speed pedal. And for that, we can use the speed chop. So let's right click on the output of the constant chop. Brings up the upgrade dialog and find the speed. The speed is like the fifth column almost at the bottom. And now if you change the value in the constant shop, if the value is zero, the speed shop will stop increasing. And if you put it to one or higher, it's going to start increasing. And depending on the input value, depending on the value of your constant shop, you can increase it slowly or you can increase it quicker. And this value we can use to export onto this parameter on the noise top, onto the transform parameter of the noise top. So to export, right click on the output of the speed, find a null, just for cleanliness, and then select the noise top so you get the parameters. And navigate to the transform page of the noise top parameters. And now export this channel onto the third parameter of the translate. So this translate parameter is literally going, the first value is in X direction, the second value is in Y, and the third value is in Z. So to export, it was activating the viewer, grabbing the channel and dropping it onto the third parameter here. And you have an animating noise. Did it go? Oh. Oh, funny. Okay. But yes. yeah, the noise top is generally a great also. There's tons of fun that just sits in the noise top. It's a good friend.
A hardworking friend.
Okay. I'm gonna go from tops now into chops and look a little bit closer at channel operators, and particularly maybe look at why, or to explain a little bit more how. Why this concept of nodes is closely related to synthesizers. And so if you have your project saved, you maybe just open up a fresh project. Just open up a new TouchDesigner and we'll get started. And I'll talk a little bit about the what we'll build next. Da-da-da. So I'll open up this simple synth audio visualizer, and it's going to take a while. What we'll basically do is we'll rebuild the simplest synthesizer in the world, because TouchDesigner can be used to make music or sound. Let's not say music, let's say sound.
Generate sound.
Generate sound. Oh. A little side note, I haven't mentioned our YouTube channel. Go to youtube.com and then in a little while. Yes. TouchDesigner. Okay. On our Touch Designer channel, we have a lot of the videos from, we had a little summit this last March in Berlin with lots of talks. And some of these talks were on music in Touch Designer. So let me just find this quickly because it's really a good one. There's one on geometrical music, which was a tight integration of Ableton and controlling Ableton from Touch Designer, which is interesting. And then Felix Larretta, he's been using Touch Designer for the last, I don't know, since it exists, he has been using it. And his networks, so he rebuilt a synthesizer in Touch Designer, including little interfaces for all the modules, and then these fairly intense networks, which are just good to show, but you gotta watch the video yourself later on. Let's see when this network comes up. It's just really impressive. Everybody needs to see that network. But it's all audio synthesis. It's absolutely amazing. And that's just parts of it. It goes deep. Totally recommend the Touch Designer YouTube channel with a lot of the talks from the summit. Okay, so what we're gonna do is we'll have this little panel here. And I'll just turn on the audio a little bit. So this is not a great synthesizer. You basically just generate some simple sounds with it by clicking. And by clicking in the panel, and you get a little visualization from it. And the basis of this is the simplest synthesizer patch, basically, that you can think about. So in a synthesizer, you have some keyboard where you control the pitch of two voltage-controlled oscillators that output either a sawtooth or here a square wave of the sine wave or something like this. So you control frequency. And you mix those down. And then you have a voltage-controlled filter, so filtering out frequencies or extracting frequencies, or you have different options there, followed by a voltage-controlled amplifier. And both of these are controlled by a gate and an envelope generator. And if I overlay this, then you kind of get the same thing. I don't have a keyboard, but I have my control panel where I can click in and move around. So that's kind of my keys. I actually have a 2D keyboard for that. I have two audio oscillators. I have a mix down, which is literally just a mass where I'm adding those two together. Then we have an audio filter, where we can high pass, band pass, or low pass frequencies. We have another math, which would be an amplifier, because it's just multiplying essentially the signal. And then it's a little bit hard to see right now with the background on, but we do have these chops called trigger chops that we get to, and those are envelope generators. Those are ADSRs, attack, sustain, release, AD. Attack, decay, sustain, release. Thank you. So they create these envelopes for us, and well, they duplicated the whole thing here to have a stereo signal, and then and then we'll get to this part hopefully as well, where we visualize the whole thing as a simple XY scope. So. Let's get started on that. The best thing perhaps is for me to open up the first file here. Actually, no, we don't need that. I just need this and this. Okay. So just to I have here, I need something that's similar to a button. A keyboard is basically a bunch of buttons. So let's place down a button first. And a button is a special kind of thing. It's a component. You can find that in the component family. When you open up the opcreate dialog, you will find in the center part all the panel elements, including buttons, sliders, fields for text entry, and similar things. So place down a button. And these buttons, as well as every other node in TouchDesigner, can be made interactive by activating the viewer. And now you have a button that you can click. It's currently a toggle. So a toggle is fine, you turn it on, turn it off. But we want to change that to a momentary button, so something that releases right away again. So let's go to the button type here and change that from a toggle down to a momentary. So that's more of a that's a button that we want. And this is in the component section. So these components, as I said earlier, they're basically networks. There's more inside. They're built, these buttons are again built from, if I just go in there, I've got a text top where I can generate text. And it's got a frame and it's got a couple, something that's called a panel chop where I can get panel states, meaning click events, the coordinates where I clicked, if I rolled over the whole thing. Because if I roll over, you see it lights up, and when I click, it lights up even more. So all of these events are in a panel chop. So if you need any information on UI panels, then this is all in the panel. There's a large amount of parameters or on channels that you can get there. And this button also has an output. There's in every family except for components has in and out operators. And these in and out operators are so that you can put information into a component and get information out of it. We did see that before when we placed the RGB delay. I'm just going to do that again to show you. This is a component as well. It's a container component. It's got the gray background here. And it's got an input and an output, blue input and blue output. So if I go inside, I can see that there's an in operator and an out operator. And you find them, there's an in here and an out. Chops have the same thing, in and out. And those are literally to create these input and output connectors to your components. So the button has the same thing. I just deactivated the viewer here to see the output. And it's got a green output, so it's got a chop output. I'm just going to add a null to it. So right click on the output there, on the green component output, and select the null chop. And this, now I can activate the viewer again since I have connected my null. And this has the state of the button. You can click it, it goes on and off. Perfect. So this is very similar to my keyboard. It's a one key keyboard so far. And we can use this to we can later use this to control the pitch, but we can already use this also as a gate. This is basically what the gate does, right? It's an on-off. Gate is an on-off state, and this is what the button gives me. So if I attach a trigger to this, let's just do that right away. right-click on the output of the null and attach a trigger chop. It's in the last column, trigger. And now if I hit this button, you can see how it goes up very quickly, then it goes to half, and then it releases. So it's very similar to this curve here, basically. Goes up, goes down, stays a little bit, goes back to its initial state. And in fact, as we did before, we can use the trail chop to have a look at that. I'm just gonna right-click on the output of the trigger and put a trail. And now if I hit the button, just hit pause to be able to investigate this a little bit better. So now I can see that it's a similar shape as this explanation here of an ADSR envelope generator. Mm-hmm. With the difference that our trigger here has certain settings that are different from this picture. Like we have the attack shape is an ease in, ease out, while the picture here is all linear. But you could change that. You can choose any kind of attack shapes. You can control the decay shapes, the release shapes. So you have full control over the look of this envelope. Delete this. The trigger is important to stay. You can keep the trail if you want. Now, the other part that's necessary for an audio, for a synthesizer, is an oscillator. And these oscillators and everything connected with audio, you can find in the first column of the chop family in the OpCreate dialog. There you have band EQs, device ins. Device in would be a microphone, for example. Like if I just put down a microphone here and let's see, pick my microphone. Oh, my microphone is currently used by this, so I cannot use this. Maybe stereo mix? No, as well not. You should be seeing movement there when you put that down, I think. I'm currently using my microphone to record, so that's actually not accessible here. Oh, wait, no, totally. I was paused. Anyway. So there you go. You have the microphone signal coming in. So this would be the audio device in. There's other interesting audio filters, like there's an audio spectrum. If you want to have a look at the spectrum of your audio signal, you can do this. There's two modes of this, I should say, for the audio spectrum. One is the visualization mode, where it gives you a nicer representation visually of the data. So what this does is it boosts the high frequencies, because the high frequencies usually have a lower overall power, and then they're not visible. But this boosts them, and it's better. Yeah, it's better for visualization purposes. But there's another mode, which is the time to magnitude and phase mode. And this can be very interesting if you're into audio, because this will give you the actual representation of a spectrum, including the phase, meaning that you have for each frequency here, for each represented frequency, you have not just the power of it, but also the phase. This gives you the possibility to convert the whole thing back into an audio waveform by taking another spectrum chop and changing from visualization, not to time to magnitude, which is the first one, but to magnitude and phase to time. So you can go full circle again. You can take an audio signal, convert it into a spectrum, do something with the signal perhaps, like change, mess up the phase or something like that, and then convert it back into an audio signal by using audio spectrum, time to magnitude and phase, and then audio spectrum, magnitude and phase to time. But that's just a side note. I'm going to delete that. Because what we want is an audio oscillator. So you can find that in the upgrade dialog. There's the audio oscillator, the first column. If you can't find it right away, there's always the search bar on top. So here I have an audio oscillator currently with a bass frequency set at 440 hertz and generating a sine waveform. I'm going to turn the amplitude down because I'm just going to output it right away. Maybe you want to do that as well. This can be a little bit obnoxious in classrooms, but... So you have the audio oscillator, and if you want to output this, you don't need an audio device in, you need an audio device out. So right-click on the output of the audio oscillator and find the audio device out. And everybody should be getting a nice phasing is happening here. Yeah. That's good. And here you have control over the frequency. So now I'm convinced that if we all get on stage, we can just perform like that. Two notes, everybody, and then just run with that. Now, you can always turn the audio device out off. It does have an active flag. So on the audio device out parameters, you can turn off the active flag. That's also very useful knowledge.
That's on the oscillator?
On the audio device out. Yeah. Okay, so that's pretty good. We have an audio oscillator here. We do have an audio device out. If we look back at this picture, what we need is maybe a second audio oscillator. Copy, paste. And what they did here in this explanation of the oscillators is that one of them has a sawtooth like or ramp thing and the other one has a square wave. So you can choose that, you can change that in the audio oscillator, in the type parameter. You can switch from sine to anything you like, ramp and square. And we can mix that down. We can combine these two with a chop called the mass chop. Right, just as a reminder, there is an active flag. So yeah, and with the mass chop can be used. The mass chop is has tons of functionality. It's probably one of those chops that's used most commonly in a project. So let's right click onto the output of audio oscillator 1 and find the math chop. Math. Oh, okay. Math. Like mathematics.
Yeah.
And by placing the math chop here, you see that it has also this a little bit bigger input. So it can take multiple inputs and act on multiple inputs. So connect the second audio oscillator onto the input of the mass chop as well. And now we have a stereo signal, but we want to combine those two together. And you can combine these by choosing in the parameters. There's a combined chops parameter here. Combined chops.
Combined chops.
So let's choose and combine chops. We'll just use add. Combined chops add. So there's a difference between, you see there's two parameters here. One is called combined channels, and the other one is called combined shops. So what's the difference there? Combined shops takes two inputs and combines all the channels together. So it takes the first channel of input one and the first channel of input two and adds them together, for example. Takes the second channel of input one, second channel of input two, and adds them together. So depending on how many channels you have in your inputs, that's as many channels as it will output. Now then there's another, then there's the combined channels, and I'll just show you what that does. If I take, just gonna choose a chop that's called the pattern chop. And you don't have to follow me here. I'll just show you. And I'll offset the phase a little bit so it makes more sense. I can combine these two channels with a mask chop as well. So I'll right click, get a mask chop, and now I can combine these channels together by adding them. So that's the difference. Here we are combining two chops, but we can combine two chops. Well, actually, let's do this. Here I have two chops. One has a sine, the other one has a triangle. And if I use a mask chop here and choose combine chops add, what it's doing is it's taking channel one of the first chop and channel one of the second chop and adds them together. Channel two and adds them together. Combining channels takes two channels of one chops and adds them. Now also, since these are in order, what I can do is I can combine the channels first. So I could add these two together and add these two together. And then add both chops together. So you can do that too. So that's the difference between combining channels and combining chops. Channels combines the channels of one chop. Combining chops takes the channels of each chop and combines them.
Okay.
That didn't make much sense. How could I explain that better? In general, if you want to take two chops and combine them, you need to choose combine chops.
Yeah. No, I understand.
So we're at step two here. We basically mix them together. And the next thing here is a voltage controlled filter. So let's right click on the output of the math and find an audio filter. The audio filter chop. Oops. Audio filter. And the audio filter has the options for low pass, high pass, band pass, or band reject. And I did write down what's good for this. Audio filter. Yeah, I mean we can just take a low pass. We'll just keep it with the low pass. Also something to watch out for here, you have two different ways to control this filter. One of them is that the cutoff units can be in logarithmic units, or they can be by specifying the frequency. Now, as it's easier to work with logarithmic units for this, but you see always that the filter cutoff, it's a disabled parameter down below. It basically shows you the frequency that you're setting there. So you can make the connection easily, you can read the hertz by changing the logarithmic version. It works the same way the other way around. You can choose cutoff units in frequency, and by changing that, you see the filter cutoff update. But I'll keep it in logarithmic. So here we have our audio filter with a low pass and a frequency that we can adjust. So the last step here was the amplifier. And the amplifier is again a mass chop, because the mass chop lets us multiply the signal by another value. So after the audio filter, right click on the output of the audio filter, find the mass chop, the first in the fourth column.
Can you just repeat that?
Oh, yeah. Which one?
Just the last sentence you said. Where are we plugging?
On the output of the audio filter,
okay.
Find the mass chop.
Okay.
And the mass chop, the parameter that we are interested in is the multiply, because this is that's an amplification, basically. And now we want to control via our trigger. If we look back at the schematics here, we have an envelope generator for the filter and an envelope generator for the amplifier. So we need two triggers. So let's take the trigger and just copy and paste it. And I'm going to rearrange my whole setup a little bit here. Actually, I move it a little bit to the side. And then because I'm going to export onto these parameters, onto the filter parameter and onto the multiply parameter, I'll need null chops for this. So let's right click on the output of trigger one and get a null chop. And let's do the same thing with the trigger two. Let's add a null chop there as well. And now let's export that to from this null. Maybe we should rename this to null filter. And this null down here we'll rename to null amplify. And I'll select the audio filter chop. I want to export to the filter cutoff frequency here. So I'll activate the null filter chop and drag the value onto filter cutoff.
The value is null. Okay.
Yeah, null filter the value onto the filter cutoff frequency. And for the null amplifier, sorry, yeah. Yes, so I haven't mentioned those funny pink things there. They come up because a lot of these exporting or sometimes these operators have side functionality in a way that you can, or where you can control certain aspects of the functionality by scripts or by tables and things like that. So when you do an export, you're going to see this little pink arrow here appear. What that tells you, you see it in other systems as well that people build. When you click on it, a node appears. So what we call this is we call this docking. We're docking other operators to operators so we can hide them. We basically can tie them to this. If I move the null, this node, this table here, moves with it. And if I don't want to see it, I can just hide it. So it's a good way, it's an organizational, it's very, very good way to organize things. But what's actually in this table is all the, the directions on what to do with this export or how to export. So you take channel V1, and it's being exported to an operator called AudioFilter1. AudioFilter1 onto the parameter that's called cutoff log. So if I roll over this parameter, I can see actually the little pop-up flag there shows me the real parameter name, cutoff log. And then an enable, which is, it's enabled currently. So you can, theoretically, you can change this enabled flag dynamically as well. So if I would change this from 1 to 0, then it stops exporting. So this can be basically scripted or controlled, but it's not that important for now, but it's good to know. Okay, so you've got that, and do the same thing now that we just did with the null filter, do the same thing with the null amplify. Export the channel from null amplify onto the multiply parameter of the mask shop. So you will have to go to the mult add page of the mask shop, activate the viewer of the null amplify shop, and drag the channel onto multiply, choose export shop, and we made all our connections. Now there's not much happening. And the biggest reason for that there's nothing happening is our audio filter here, which is a low pass, but we're cutting it off at nothing. And then we're going to 10 Hertz or something like that. So there's no, so we have to do something with this value. And what better than a mask chop? So we can insert a mask chop here to change the values of the trigger, what's coming out from the trigger. The trigger currently produces a 0 to 1. And with a mask chop, we can rearrange that to, like we maybe want to control that, that we go from 4 down to 2. So let's add a mask chop after the trigger. Right click on the output of the trigger chop and add a mask. Trigger one, yeah. And here again, we can use the range page to say our input values is 0 to 1. Our output values should be 4 to 2, for example. So now we're passing something through. We're always letting everything through, and then we're cutting off frequencies. And the last step perhaps is to, and I wrote just down a couple of values there. What we would have to do now is change the envelope settings for the trigger. So we have full control over attack lengths. How long does it take for the trigger to go from 0 to 1? And we could set the attack lengths to, for example, something small like 0.06 seconds. And then the peak level will stay at, will cut the peak lengths to 0. I basically just wrote down a couple values that work a little bit. The decay lengths I also set to 0.06 seconds.
What is the zero?
I set that to 0.06 on attack level. Attack length. Sorry, attack length.
Attack length. Okay.
Yeah. Peak length I set to 0 here. Then sustain, the decay length I set to 0.06. And then I left the release length, I left at 0.3, just for, and now for the trigger two, we can set the trigger two probably with a longer attack length, 0.08, and peak length 0.1, so it stays on for a bit. We leave the peak length basically, and then on the sustain, I didn't change that. I changed the decay length to 0.17 and release length I left as well. And that was my my first synthesizer. And you can shape the sound nicely by changing the trigger. Just those playing around with these parameters, you can create a variety, a large variety of sounds. Oh, there's in Montreal, Owen Kirby. Do you know Owen Kirby?
Owen Kirby?
No, he also built a synthesizer in TouchDesigner. Mm-hmm. It's hilarious. You should, if you meet him, Kadi knows him, but I think, yeah. Owen Kirby, yeah. So one more thing, we literally created this whole synthesizer patch here. The one thing that we haven't done yet is we are not controlling the pitch yet. So we need to do that somehow. And the audio oscillators actually have a pitch control input. The first input to the audio oscillator gives you exactly control over that. And now we just need to have an XY, because if you remember in my little, I closed it again, but in the example file, depending on where I clicked or where I dragged it, it created a different frequency. So let's try to get this XY from this button. And I said earlier that the panel values for this button actually have the position on where you clicked on the button. So to make it easy, we can just place down a panel chop. So hit tab and find the panel chop. A panel. It's the panel chop. Whoops. Panel. And for the panel chop, we need to specify the panel that it grabs its values from. By default, it says it gets it from the component project one, which is the component we're actually building our thing inside. And just for now, we want to get it from the button. So let's take this button and just drop it onto the panel, like that. So I grabbed it by the name because it's activated. So I grabbed the node by its name here and just drop it onto the panel component, panel chop. So what that does, it's a shortcut essentially. What it does is it takes the path of the button and puts it into the component path in the parameters. I could also take this button and drop it right in here into the parameter, but this is a quick way of doing that. And now if I zoom in a little bit, I can see that there's U and V values right there. So I want to use those U and V values as my pitch control for my oscillators. And since there are so many channels here, the panel chop has a select parameter where I can select out certain values or certain channels. So either I know that I'm looking for U and V and I can type it in here, or I can click on this little drop-down menu again and find U and find V. U and V. And now when I click and drag my mouse on the button, I can see those changing. Okay, now we need to somehow get the U channel into the pitch control of the first oscillator and the V channel into the first input of the audio oscillator too. And I can do this with a chop called the select chop. The select, so, yeah.
When you over the mouse button,
yeah.
Change.
Oh, I clicked.
Ah, click. Okay.
Click and drag. Yeah.
Thanks.
Then you see the UV change. There's more parameters. There's also a rollover U and a rollover V, which would change when you are rolling over without clicking.
Okay.
So I'll right click on the output of this panel chop and find a select. And in the select, it's very similar to the select parameter of the panel chop. Here it's named channel names. And there I can select U, for example, or I type it in to this parameter, channel names. And this one I can plug straight into the pitch control of the first audio oscillator. And if I copy and paste this select and put a V in here, because I want to select the V channel and plug it into the second one, you successfully have created that little setup here. Sounds like we have success. Let me know if that works, because the next thing I would show you is a little sideshow, so to say.
Safe.
Safe. Oh, right. Yes. Thank you. Safe. You currently have this as a button element, so you would have to click on a screen to control it or on something. But what if you want to control it with other devices? What if you want to control it with a MIDI controller or with a phone, for example? So I'll, let's do MIDI first. And I brought a rather heavy USB MIDI thing here and a little MIDI controller. So, to establish a connection to a MIDI device, it would be that you go to Dialogues. And on the Dialogues, you have the MIDI device mapper. So click on that and bring up the MIDI device mapper. It's a little dialog that, just by the way, if you hit F10, you can explore how the MIDI device mapper is built. Yeah, we tried to collapse the whole thing into itself. and here what I would do, or if you have a MIDI device, like there's a lot of these USB MIDI devices that you just plug in, right? Yes, right like that. You click create new mapping. Yeah, so you go to Dialogues and MIDI device mapper.
Okay.
Right, the Dialogues menu, yeah. Sorry. Yes. And MIDI device mapper. And it should be empty. And then when you hit create new mapping, you get a couple selectors. One would be for the in device. So here's where I choose my first input of my MIDI USB device. You can select an out device. And I'll show you a nice trick for that, at least for Windows machines. And that's pretty much it. If I move my sliders here, I have MIDI coming in. I can tell from the monitor here, from the MIDI console, that this is working. And and MIDI comes in as chops as well, because MIDI is control data. So you will find in the chop section, there is a MIDI in. It's the MIDI in chop. And there you have tons of options of what kind of stuff you want to get in from your media device. It's, I don't think it's the complete set of MIDI controls, but everything that's fairly good usable. There's another operator that might be interesting if you're doing more complex things. There's also a MIDI in DAT. It's something I won't be covering much, DATs. But what a MIDI DAT basically does, it comes in as raw data, and then you can run these callbacks here in Python. You basically can run callback functions on each event that you get. So it's a much more precise way of dealing with MIDI data. But just on the side. We will be keeping the MIDI in chop just for now. Uh-huh. And I've got my two sliders here, first and second slider, because I want to control the pitch for both. And so I can select those out, for example. I can select my first one with a select chop. I would get the first channel. And now MIDI comes in between 0 and 127. So I'll have to change that data a little bit with a mass. 0 to 127 would be, we can do actually minus 1 to 1.
Sorry, I lost.
Oh, okay, sorry. Do you have the MIDI in?
Yes.
Does it work?
It's working, yeah.
So then I just put a select chop there to select out one of the channels.
Okay.
And then a mass chop to change the values, because the MIDI values come in as 0 to 127. Yes. And the pitch is basically, it's one octave per unit.
Ah, okay.
So you want to change with a mass chop, you would want to change these values from 0 to 127 to 0 to 1 or so.
Yeah.
And then I can connect that to the pitch.
But 0 to 127,
It's just the MIDI value, actually. It's not a pitch wheel or something like that. Yeah, so the audio, yeah, you can set how it should act. So here it's the units per octave is set to 1, so that means if I change from 0 to 1, it goes up 1 octave.
Perfect.
Yeah. Right, so I could change this, for example, to 1 divided by 127, and I could use the MIDI data straight up. Yeah. And that should give you control, basically, over the pitch. If I
in the math,
the math, I changed the range.
Oh, okay.
Something like this. Similarly, while I'm at it, you can also get OSC data in. So if you want to get it from other software or other devices like a phone, then an OSC chop would be your best friend for this. There's an OSC in. And there's also the same as I said for DATs, for MIDI, where there's a MIDI DAT. The same also exists for the for OSC, where you can have an OSC DAT, which is much more useful there, because OSC can have text data, strings, and stuff like that. So then it really makes sense to use a DAT for that. So this OSC in here can take any OSC data, and there's a nice little app that comes for Android phones and for iPhones. It's called Zixin. Not sure if you know that. Let's find that. Zixin. It's a free app. Zixim. Actually, they do have a website. And what Zixim does is it gives access to all the sensors of your phone. It doesn't have much of an interface, but you do we have images here? No. But there is a sick simulator. It's trying to find the actual web page. I can't find the web page, but that's okay. I'll show you how it works. It's basically you go into. It's really super simple interface. You have on the sensor page, you can select which sensors it should output. Then you have a settings page where you would have to set the IP address of the computer that you're sending to. So I would just have to figure that out. IP config, that's not how it's spelled. Config. No, dash A? What? Okay. Now we just have to find an IP number here. This looks good. So I'm going to type in this IP number. 192.168.0.217. And the port number here is set to 10,000, so that's okay. And I can hit start. So this one is. And that's maybe not my IP. Let's try to find a different IP. Well, that would have been too nice. 217. Start. I can't get to my computer. Lights up red. Sorry, one second. Let's see.
Maybe the IP number is wrong.
Yeah. Gonna check here. Properties. TCPI. No, status. Details. 192.168.0.217. Do I have... This is disconnected. No, I can't get to it. It doesn't connect. That's unfortunate. Theoretically, you would see the data basically streaming in the same way into the OSCN. And you could do the same thing that we just did with the MIDI, connected to the audio oscillators as a pitch input. But why wouldn't it? Okay, one more try. OSCN. Do I have a firewall? I'm just going to turn off my firewall for a while. Okay. And let's try that again. No. I don't get to my computer. So anyway, that's something to try out at home. Maybe you have more luck with that setting that up. It's usually a pretty painless process, but sometimes Wi-Fi can be funny. Anyway, what you would have to do is basically make sure that you have the right port number set and the IP, and then you would get all this data that this app produces come in. Similarly, if you have Ableton and you want to get connected to Ableton via this, it also is on the OSC protocol. And there's a large article on our wiki about the TD Ableton package, which should get you going in that sense too. Okay, but here we are with our little synthesizer. And the one thing that I did in my sample network was that I actually had two different, that I wanted to create a stereo signal with it to visualize it better. And one thing I did for that was literally just, was just copying this part of the network. So I would copy everything, the audio oscillator, all the way down, except for the audio device out. So this whole portion here, you can just copy and paste. So I'm selecting the audio oscillator, including all the triggers, but not the audio device out. And I just copy and paste it. So I use the right mouse button to do that. Right mouse button to select it. Copy, paste. And now I can merge those two chains together with a merge chop. So it's literally audio oscillators here, the null, all the triggers. And then after the first math, I would add a merge chop. The merge. And what the merge lets me do, it's just taking many, many inputs and putting them into merging channels together. So I have two channels as an output.
Did you create an extra math?
Nope, just a merge. You could theoretically use a math as well, because the first thing what a math does without modifying any of the parameters is merging channels. But yeah. And now you have a stereo signal. It's probably good just to change the we can change the type of the oscillator of our second synthesizer branch here a little bit. So instead of a ramp and a sine, maybe I'll use a triangle and use a triangle and a sine. And now we have a signal that we can visualize, because what we want to build was an XY scope. And an XY scope is basically an oscillator. You use, to put a picture like an oscillator, you take, if we explore this channel here a little bit, we have a bunch of samples here. And you can do this by activating a viewer to explore this whole channel a little bit. It's an interactive viewer. So you can zoom in and you can explore all the single samples here. And it's going to be hard to see. But essentially what it is, what an XY scope does, it takes one channel, the left channel, and maps it to X values of a coordinate system. And then it takes the second channel and maps it to the Y coordinates of your coordinate system, meaning you take a point and you take the first sample of your input audio, and it's going to move that point to this first value, the second point to the second value, etc. So similar as I described with I'll just show you quickly. If I take a circle sub and convert it to a chop, for example, then this is the same translation. This is my x values, this is my y values, creates a circle. And here I have x and y values, and I want to create a geometry out of it. And if I map them one to one, it's an xy scope, it's an oscilloscope.
You can make a form.
Yeah, okay. You can make a form. And the form we can make very simple. Down here, I showed you a circle, a sub, to a chop, but we can go the other way around as well. We can take a chop and convert it into a sub. Okay. So if you find this operator, it's called a, well, it's called a chop to sub. So if you hit tab and go to the sub family and then find the chop to sub, then now we can take the merge, or actually, you know what? We should have a null.
Null. Yeah. My friend.
And the null, maybe the null should also be in a different branch. Like, we don't want the null in between the merge and the audio device. So we can create a different branch, and that's something I haven't mentioned yet. You can branch out by middle mouse clicking onto, oh, now it's difficult if you don't have a middle mouse button. But when you middle mouse click onto the output of a operator and put a null down, then it creates a new branch. The other way of this would be just to place the null and just connect it. Another way would be to put it in line and then just reconnect the merge to the audio device out. And now we can take this null and drop it onto the chop 2. The chop 2 currently is pretty much erroring. It's saying invalid input chop. Because it needs, as a parameter, it needs a chop. It needs to know where to get its data from. So you can take the null, and just as before, we can just drop it onto the sub, because there's only one parameter where this chop actually fits into. It does it for us automatically, fills in this address. So null 3, the name of this chop, is now here in the chop field. And, well, it's still giving us a warning, so let's have a look. It says, warning, channel TX not found, TY not found, TZ. It's missing those channels, so we have to rename them. Here we have U and U1. That's bad channel naming on my side. I just didn't name them properly. But we can change the channel scope from TX, TY, TZ to U and U1. And now it's still warning us about something. It says that there's more attribute values than channels specified. So this is an interesting thing about this operator, about the sub, because it doesn't just let you set point positions. Okay. It gives you access to all kinds of attributes, geometry attributes. So, and that's perhaps why it has an input. You could theoretically input a geometry into this sub and then change geometry attributes like normals or point color or other things by specifying them here in the attribute scope. So you can set point position, you can set point color, point normals, and you can also offset texture coordinates. Who's done 3D before? So a couple of those attributes are then familiar, basically. And you can do a lot of animation via then using chops to offset or manipulate those. Anyway, so currently we have chosen here attribute scope P0 to P2, which means those are the point attributes, positional attributes, but we only have two input channels. So we should delete the third one here, which would be our Z. This is the Z coordinate theoretically. So the channel scope would be UU1 and the attribute scope P0 and P1. And now, you should be seeing something. That's also something I didn't mention yet. Needs a longer explanation. I'll do that last. But if you want to see this, like, this is now pretty tiny here. I can hardly see what it's outputting here in the geometry. You can always right click on a node and then select view. So if I right click on the chop 2 and select view, it's going to give me a little window which I can move around, make a little bit bigger. And now I can better investigate what I'm creating here. So my setup, which might look totally different for all of you because of different values, I'm basically creating these kind of waveforms with my little synthesizer. Does that work for everyone?
Yes.
Good. Save. Thank you. We have an auto save reminder. That's good. Well, I mentioned that earlier. What we have now is geometry. So we don't have pixels. We have geometry that we... there's ways of displaying this on a second screen, but mostly, most likely we would like to render this whole thing and put it on a projector. So somehow we have to get from this blue node to, which is SOPs, surface operators, to our TOPS, texture operators. I'm just going to close this window again. And now this process is a little bit funny, but it's one of those, it's like exporting. It's something that you just remember and then it's okay. So the thing is that we have this, this SOP here lives in something that would be referred to as object space. It's its own little object. And to render it, we have to move it into world space. And to do that, there's a shortcut here, which I would much recommend to use. To do this conversion, basically, you have to put it into a geometry component. You have to encapsulate the whole thing into a geometry component, which is then being rendered. And to create this geometry component, I right-click on the output of the chop 2, and then I go to the component level where I have all my 3D objects, and I choose geometry. And this geometry I can place somewhere. Now, what it did is it created this geometry component for me. And if I go inside, it added an in operator and an out operator. And it did two more things. It set up these little flags here. These flags is something I haven't talked about much, and I should probably talk about them more. We know the viewer active flag. We have used that before. To the left beside it is a display flag. This display flag has multiple uses for the sub. on one hand, it makes it possible to see this sub one level up in the geometry view of the geometry component. It's being displayed there as well. And then to the left of it is the render flag. And this render flag needs to be set for this geometry to render. If I don't have the render flag on, it's not going to be taken into consideration. The other two is template and compare flags, which are not important at this point. So theoretically, the workflow would be to put down a geometry component, delete the torus, place an insub, set the render display and render flag, go outside, connect the whole thing. That's way too much work. The easy way is right click on the output of the sub that you want to render, go to the component family, and put down a geometry component. Now, what else is needed to render stuff? Usually we need a camera. So the camera is also in the component family. So hit tab and go to the component family and find a camera. And for this purpose, because we are just creating a line, essentially, we don't need any shading. We don't need any like lights. We don't really need that for this. So what we can though add is this thing needs a material. It needs to know how to be rendered, what color it should get. So with this, we discover another component family called the matte materials. And I'm just going to choose a constant matte here. And a constant matte literally doesn't do anything but give the geometry a constant color. So there's no shading, there's no taking into consideration any lights, or it's just a constant color. And this material here has to be somehow connected to the geometry. This geometry needs to know what material to use when it's being rendered. And so when you click on the geo component, you see tons of parameters in the geo component. You can transform this, this whole thing. There's something called instancing, which I don't think we'll get into, but instancing is a way of taking a geometry like this, what we created, sending it to the GPU, and then creating copies or instances of that geometry on the GPU many, 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 many times. And then using channels to offset, like to manipulate that geometry. So you can create very complex geometries with instancing without much impact on your CPU. But we want to look at the render page. And the render page has a material parameter. And that's where we can drop the constant material onto. So it's the render page of the geometry comp, and take the constant mat and drop it onto there. And last but not least, we need to render this. And rendering we do with the render top. So if you hit tab and go to the top family, you can find a render top. And we'll place it. And now there's an interesting flag that I hadn't talked about before. The render top, or all tops, also have this display flag. And if you hit the display flag, if you turn it on, it's actually putting it into the background of your network. So this little blue flag, click that to see it. And now you should be able to see a rendered image in the background of your network. If it's too small, you can always go to the geometry component onto the transform page and just scale it up. This those You could also do this in the SOP, like on the SOP level. And this is a little bit of a performance thing. Like I could put a transform SOP after the chop to SOP here and scale it up. But if I do this, then it's very expensive on the CPU. It is calculated on the CPU. Well, if I do the transforms on the geometry component itself, including the scale, then it's basically for free. You can animate that and do anything you would like. It doesn't have any performance impact. So that's good. We've got this rendered. And this is literally the render setup as you would have most render setups. If you're rendering spheres or any other objects that need to be shaded, then you add lights to it. We do have, as a recent addition, we added PBR materials. PBR materials is physical-based rendering, so you can get really nice, nice-looking shading. Another operator that's interesting for the PBR material is the substance top. Substance is, there's a software called Substance Designer, which lets you create materials. If you go to the website, Substance Designer, then they have a very large community that shares their materials as well. So you can download lots of materials for free from there under the community section here, Substance Share. And these materials here, so you can get basically, yeah, nicely done materials. Those are all, they come with parameters, so you can adjust the parameters as well. If you have a wood material, for example, then usually you can adjust the granularity of the wood. And this comes in straight into TouchDesigner by the substance top. It's a good thing to remember. What else on rendering? That's pretty much it. So let's add a null top after the render one. And let's put the display flag actually on the null. That's better because we're going to add stuff here. Maybe you just saw when I did this, you can have many, many of these operators displayed in the background. It's not limited to one display flag. You can have a display flag on as many of these as you like. So, like that, basically. One nice thing that I wanted to add to our little synthesizer and visualization is feedback. Everybody needs feedback. It's like the main ingredient to 90% of everything. So feedback is the process of taking an image and kind of, it's almost like, well, you're looping it back into the same chain. And TouchDesigner is not necessarily happy when you connect in loops. It's going to complain about it. You want to at least give it maybe, it's probably better to give it previous frame or something like this. It's basically you need to set up a little loop with a special operator, which is called the feedback operator. And to do this feedback operator, we'll just place it down. I'll just hit tab, and it's a top because we are creating a top feedback. You can also create chop feedback loops, but for this we'll take a top feedback here. And this top feedback, it basically, it needs an initial image. It needs an initial source. So we'll connect the render to the input of the feedback. And then we somehow have to composite the feedback with the, like you have to close the feedback loop somehow. Usually it's a composite process. You take the last frame and you add it onto the current frame or something like that. So in here, we want to insert an, let's say we'll take an add top. And well, there's many ways of adding operator. One of the ways I haven't shown you yet is when you mouse over the wire, you can right click when the wire turns yellow and you can say insert operator. And up comes the upgrade dialog. You choose add. And we'll connect the feedback to the add. So that's pretty good. We have no feedback. So why do we have no feedback? Because the feedback actually doesn't know where to grab the image from. It gets an initial image as its input, but it needs the output, our final output, as its input again, right? To make a feedback loop. Like a feedback loop theoretically would look like this, but then it would go crazy and you need an initial resolution to it. So the way to close this feedback loop is actually by setting the target top parameter on the feedback parameter, on the feedback top. So our target top is the add, and we'll plug it in there. And now if I click, it's drawing on top of each other, and you're basically drawing on the screen. Like it's not releasing the information from the screen. So usually what you do after the feedback as a first as a first intervention here would be to add a level top. So let's right click on the output of the feedback top and add a level. And on the level, the post page on the level has an opacity. And if we dial that down to something like 0.95, then we would get a really long or fairly long feedback here. So you have a little feedback effect. How strong that feedback is, you can control, like how long the trail of that feedback is, you can control via the opacity in this instance.
Safe.
Yeah. Now, if you look closely, you see that here on the projector as well, there's a gray residue that it leaves behind that can be really ugly. And this is due to rounding errors. The thing is that you render by default, you render at 8-bit color resolution. So 8-bit means you have per channel, you have 256 values for each color. And that's not a lot. Now, if you, in the feedback loop, every time it goes around, the 256 is multiplied by 0.949. And at a certain value, it starts, and at some point, it starts rounding to these 256 values that you have. And it gets stuck at a value of like 0.01 or something like that, because there's just, it's always rounding up. When you do 0.001 times 0.949, you get 0.01 or something like that. So you can, especially for feedbacks, it's very interesting to know that on the common page of all tops, you can set the pixel format. And the pixel format, you have a wide range of color formats here. mostly a 16-bit float will be enough. A 16-bit float gives you, I don't know, 24,000 steps per, no, somebody is better in math.
Yes. Something.
How is it? It's 2 to the power of 16? 65,000. For 32, which would be the next one up, it would be more. But usually 16-bit float is pretty good for these kind of things. And now, because of the feedback being in a feedback loop, it doesn't update its it doesn't update the pixel value after I set it. So you can go to the feedback top and reset the feedback loop. And if you but it's more pretty.
It's more pretty.
It's more shiny. it takes up more GPU memory.
Yeah.
It's more expensive to process, but in a lot of cases it's useful. It's useful.
You mean more expensive power?
Yeah. It's useful for feedbacks. It's useful for blurs as well. You can get. Ramps, you don't get the banding so much in it. Lots of uses for it. Chinese stuff, exactly. One of the nice things about this feedback loop is that since you have created this feedback loop, you can add more and more operators into it. It doesn't just, your feedback loop is not limited to a level. You can go absolutely insane by adding an edge. Right click on the output of the level and pick an edge top. And now you have something that is just going by itself. And you can adjust the parameters to dial that in a little bit, maybe. So if you change the strength to something smaller. It's too small. But you can basically create these kind of what's that? It's really popular right now. Diffusion
reaction.
It looks a little bit in that direction. It's not diffusion reaction, but you can basically make it look in that. It's a cheap copy. It's a fake copy. It's not. It's definitely not that. But if you want to do diffusion reaction, there's a lot of GLSR code. That you can just, people have done that in TouchDesigner as well. But that's not the only thing. In these feedback loops, you literally can go, just do whatever you like. HSV adjust. HSV adjust with a hue offset of 10 means that for every cycle, it's going to shift your hue by 10 degrees. So, if it's more, I need more edge here. Let's add a lot of it. No, I need way more. Let's just go full. Why? Oh, the edge here. Right. Sorry. Because my edge draws on top of it in red every time, then my hue offset doesn't do much. Okay, let me fix that. I'm just going to delete the edge and keep the HSV, but I'll change my color to red. And now my opacity to 1. And now you get a nice rainbow of things going, if you must. I'm not encouraging you to do that, but you basically, what I wanted to tell you by this is that feedback loops is not just try anything that's available to you in operators and put it into feedback loops. You can also add feedback loops into feedback loops to do multiple feedback loops. Maybe just as a simple example, there is a nice tool here. I think it's, oh, it's not a tool, no. It's an image filter called the pixel relocator. And I just gonna show you this quickly because to set it up, the pixel relocator is essentially, it's almost like a displace, but I'm going to bring in our trusty banana, and a noise top, with the noise top at a 1280 by 1020, and I'll animate that noise very, very slowly. And I'll save that out for you so you have it. It's just a couple notes to quickly set up, so I'll just do it quickly to show you what it does, what happens when you have multiple feedback loops inside of each other. A little bit more here. And this noise will make a nice, this is also good if you have 32-bit noise. Because what then happens is, so what basically happens here is that the noise takes each pixel and displaces the pixel, but it leaves nothing behind, it leaves black behind. While the displace top itself takes a pixel and offsets it, but it's being replaced by something else. So there's a slight difference there. Now if I change the amplitude here, so this is not what I want to show you though. So I've got this tiny little offset on my banana. Now I'm going to build quickly a feedback loop here. Feedback number one, ta-da, there, and a null, great. And just turn off these things here. So I've got my banana a little bit deforming. Can be deformed maybe a little bit more. But now I'm going to wrap this into a feedback loop so that this output here is the input to everything. And now if I make the noise, color noise, so that I have different offsets in X and in Y, you can get nicely squirrely things. You can do, by changing the noise, you can really change the behavior of how this is reacting. So this is one of those examples where feedback packed into feedback with some stuff going on in the middle.
Feedback is a friend.
Yes. Yeah. Absolutely. It's a really. Let's add an HSV adjust into this. Anyway, you can go pretty far with that. One thing, now that I built this actually, because I said I would share that with you, if it's often that you have these kind of things that you want to share with people. There is a nice little function when you select operators here, you might want to collapse them into a component that's shareable. So you can select these and see how I'm, oh, actually I need this one because it closes the feedback loop. So I need another null here. Okay, so I will be selecting the whole inside here. not the image that drives it and not the final output, but all the other nodes. And now I right click somewhere in the component, or sorry, somewhere on the network, but not on a node. And then there is this collapse operators, collapse selected. And it packs it into a component. Now, if I right click onto that component and say save component.tox, then this is being saved as a feedback. Feedback. Save. And now going to my desktop here, I have my feedback, which I can just drag in. So you have this saved as a component that's reusable, shareable, with an input, with an output set up, so people can just connect. And that's where it comes in with the custom parameters. If you want to control certain parameters, you add parameters on the on this level here by, just as a reminder, customize component, adding pages, adding parameter pages, adding parameters, and building out the system like that. So yeah, that's this. Back to our initial project though. I just gonna remove this HSV adjust here and change my opacity back to something normal. So one more step that I wanted to do with you here is that currently we control the whole thing via this button, and we have a background image as the like we see it only in the background. But what if I wanted to make this interactive, or what if I want to put this on a screen and have people, like if I would have a touch screen, people could interact directly on the touch screen with it. So what I want to do here is I want to output this as the background of a panel where I can get panel values from, like select U and V. And I want to have this as my window, as my perform window as well, as a full output onto a screen or something like this. So we will be using the window component again. So let's have a look at this. The idea behind this now is that we are already in project one. And project one, by default, what we do is project one is a so-called container component. And a container component is almost like a button or a slider or a field. It just has a different subset of functionality. It doesn't act like a button necessarily. Like it doesn't have a state. A button has a state on off. Container doesn't know about that. A container only cares about selecting it, like a, if you click down, and the UV, basically, those kind of things. So it's a little bit different. What a container, though, but this is equal, the same thing with buttons and everything, it can have a background top so that you can put your final creation as the background of the container. And how do we set it up? We'll just use this project one container that we already have. So I'm gonna exit this network by just zooming out, and I end up here in my little in root with project one as a container. And if I look at the parameters for this container, we have layout parameters where we can set a size for the container. So here we could, for example, even with the non-commercial, I can set this to 1920 by 1080 or any other size without problem. There's a lot of parameters here that we do have workshop videos which explain how to build panels with all of these parameters. But there's a look page, and this look page, you can specify the background top to your parameter, to your panel. Now, I'm just gonna go in again. So my background that I wanna show here is currently called null 4, but I'm just gonna rename it to background because then it's easier to identify. So the last null in your network just call that background.
The touch is sensitive to uppercase.
It's uppercase sensitive. Can you actually, we have a couple of funny rules, but you can do this. Yeah, you can do this. You can mix match uppercase, but it's case sensitive.
Okay.
Yeah. So when having called this background, I'll go back up to my project one container again. I'm in root. You can follow this here in the pane navigation bar here. And now on the look page, the background top, I can set to this background top inside. And this notation here is something that might be familiar for, like, from Unix or from Apple or I guess Windows too. So .slash means inside myself slash a node name. So if I want to specify the background top here, it would be .slash bg. Now I can activate this viewer here. I don't see anything because, well, I need to activate the synthesizer. But down here on the bottom, you see my button, actually. And the thing is that because this is a panel and how we build panels, you can put buttons and stuff into your container and build a big, interface. So right now, okay, that's nice. We can control this whole thing with this little button here. It's a little bit unsatisfactory for people that stand in front of a touch screen and now have these 10 by 10 pixels down there to interact with. So we'll fix that. We'll go inside project one. And I kind of mentioned that before. When we put down this panel chop initially to get the values from the button, the default parameter, the default component that it was looking at was actually slash project one. If you remember, it said slash project one in there. And then we changed it to button one by dragging button one onto it. So we could change that back. We could say, we could give it a full pass. Like we could say, look at slash project one. But this is kind of bad practice because if I name this project one and now I rename the container project one, like if I go here and name this my awesome or something, my synth, then sure, it warns me about this. But essentially, this chop would break because slash project one doesn't exist anymore. So it's better practice to do this kind of notation where you say dot dot, as in Unix and Mac and everywhere. Dot dot meaning my parent. One level up. Look at one level up. And this evaluates to, if you roll over the parameter, you will see that this actually evaluates to my synth, which I named my. So it's notation, pass notation, basically. So this UV here is now not driven by the button anymore, but by specifying the parent of myself here via this dot dot. Now the UV is driven by the UV of the of this container panel. So the last thing we have to do is get this. Currently, I have to click the button to get the gate. But we can get this also from this panel here. We selected earlier. We selected UV only, but there's more channels hiding there. We have select, which is more a general select. We also can select only the left mouse button, middle mouse button, right mouse button, We can see if the container is being resized. You have, if somebody hits the control key while being over the container, you can get that as a channel as well. There's our UVs that we have already. You have the insight. If your mouse is inside the container, you can fetch that as well. Radio states, clicks, how many times somebody clicked on it. But what we're interested in is basically select. When somebody clicks onto this container, we want this as a gate. So you should have in this panel, you should have UV and select. And now we somehow have to replace the inputs of these two null jobs. We don't want to get this from the button. We want to get this from this panel. And only the select channel should do that because the select is an on-off. It's like a button. So we need a, it's, yeah, the, I'm going a little bit crazy with this, but because we have a select channel and I need a select job to select the select channel. So let's put down a select job. Select. And as the input of the select, we'll take the panel job here. By default, the parameters of the select job have a star in the channel names, and star meaning select everything. Sure. But as I said, we want to select the select channel. So now you see U is going here, V is going to the second audio oscillator, and the select channel is going down to our third select here. And the output of the select, we can just replace what's coming from the null, we can replace what's coming from the button one. We'll just replace with this select here. Does everybody, can everybody follow that? And now if I zoom out, I can control the whole thing via, like when clicking onto this container here. Now the we want to get rid of the button. We can just delete the button inside. The other option for not showing a button would be on the panel page. The panel page has a display parameter. If you turn the display off, it's going to be hidden. It's still functional, but it's not showing up. So you can either turn off display on the button's panel parameter page, or just delete it because we really don't need it. And as a final step, we want to output this container as the full screen, like as our full output. And when you open up TouchDesigner, what you already get is there's already one window component in this whole system. And this window component is named perform. It's this one, and it's in slash, and it's called perform. It's in the root of the whole network called perform. But I will have to specify for this window component to look at my container here, which I called my synth. So I'll drag it onto the operator parameter again of the window component. And I do want my opening size to be filling the screen. So I set opening size to fill. And I turn my borders off. And I hit save. And I can open it. I can open it as a perform window that I can interact with. Not a very exciting animation going on there, but again, having the idea of this as a touch screen or something like this, it would translate one to one as being able to control this by touch. So another question that came up was about saving this out as a movie, for example, if you wanted to do this. And there's a movie out top. So if we right click, for example, on the output of our background top, there's a movie out, movie file out top. And this movie file out, you can choose between the various video codecs, including Cineform, HAP and HAPQ. If you have an NVIDIA GPU, you can do a 264 or a 265. Animation is basically completely uncompressed, so huge file sizes. Photo motion JPEG a little bit less. I'm not sure actually, I think there's one codec, it might be GoPro Cineform. No, it's working. I think they're all open. You can, and you basically, you have a file that it's writing out to, and then you just hit record, and it's gonna output as a movie. If your real-time flag is on and you're dropping frames, the movie will drop frames. You would have to turn the real-time flag off and then render out a movie from your animation. It's fairly simple, though. You can also specify audio to record the audio with it. So since we have audio here, you could take the null chop. Multiple render passes? But then you would have to output as separate movies with many movie file codes.
Okay.
So you would write the depth into alpha or something like that. Absolutely. You can, there's a couple ways of the node to mention perhaps for this would be the reorder. There's a top called reorder, and the reorder lets you takes multiple inputs, up to four inputs, and then you can say, okay, my red channel output should come from the first input, the red channel, and then you could have a second input with a Z data or something like this. I guess you would have to go animation codec for, yes, that's the only one. Oh, right, image sequences, right, because you also can render out image sequences then as TIFF, yeah. You could also render it out as HAPQ alpha, but that's compressed, and it's not, you probably want to have 16-bit too, or something like that, for depth data. So you probably, I think currently it would be image sequence.
I saw when you are passing, you use some frames.
Yeah.
Is there any way to separate the field of the render of the field of the UI?
to like main light action or something?
I'm not
rock trained.
No. That's it's literally there's something we're working on, something called a process component, which will be running on a separate thread, and that will be that will make it more possible to do that. But currently, when you're in the network, and depending on the load on your computer, you're going to lose frames when you're live patching. Especially, there's a couple of things where what's causing this here.
At that point, the patches are smaller, you don't have so much frames.
Yeah.
You can the render.
Correct. You could. What's sometimes helpful is turning off viewers, because every viewer here is it's separate. It's showing you data, so it's working, and there's overhead there. So you can turn it off, for example, and this would be less, but you still see that I'm dropping frames, which is actually ridiculous. Hey, I'm going to send this computer back. Am I recording? No, I'm not recording. Theoretically, it should be fine. It's actually better if I do this, if I use the middle mouse click. Oh no, it's the same. Well, anyhow, so it's dropping frames, yeah. yes, so we've got that done. That's good. We're rendering out a movie. That's very good too.
Yes. Is there a way to automatically
open the phone? Yes, absolutely. So. Correct. Yeah, no, that's important. There's a dialogue as well, which is called the window placement dialogue. And the window placement dialogue has an option start in perform mode, which allows you exactly that. If you set this option on and then save, then the next time it would come up just as a perform mode.
Which you
escape, you could go out. Correct. Yeah. Some things maybe about performance that would be important to mention when you mostly you have an interface on your laptop screen and then an output for the computer. It's very, very heavy to render two separate windows. So what you want to do is you want to create a very wide output plane, so to say, with one side the your controls and the other side the final image. And because I don't have enough time to get into this, but there is videos online that we have, or full tutorials as well, that deal with panel building, which will show you how to set up these kind of stretched work or panels which cover multiple monitors. And then you only open up this one window. It's one window that you open up, not two. That's a huge performance impact. I might mention a couple more things because it's, I'll do 10 minutes just giving you a short rundown about tools in the palette that might be interesting to you. And then if you have more questions, we'll get to that. We have in the palette, which is useful as tools, there is something called the, where is it? We have CamSnapper. CamSnapper for projection mapping. It's basically a camera component itself with a little interface, which allows you to load in a 3D object. Very simple cube here. And then you select 5 points on this 3D object and open up an output render where you will see and I can try this here. It's going to look a little bit funny because it's going to overlay output 1.1, open output. So what you will basically see is something like this on your projection. And if you want to project onto a cube, what you now would do is you take each of these corners of the cube
and place them on the cube.
Yeah. Exactly. And what this does, it's calculating the position of your projector.
Okay.
Which then is your camera that you're rendering your scene with. And therefore, you always render it from the correct position. So that's, yeah, that thing is called Cam Snapper. With the projector, yeah. Yeah, it calculates the position of the projector, including some of the zoom and...
No, it doesn't work. The image has moved the projector.
It moves the... You need a 3D object for that, because it needs the positions in world space to align to. Yeah.
Yeah, it's a 10-foot.
Oh!
Yeah,
oh shit! Holy shit!
Yeah, okay.
Wow!
Chicos, más que nada, por si alguno se tiene que ir en el colectivo o algo, el subte ya se rodó. Because the subway is
closed. It's closed, right? Yeah. Yeah. All right. Well, I guess I'll stop here. there's lots more to cover, but have a look on our website also. I need to point you to the tutorial page, which is under education, derivative.ca. There's a little education tab. And I think, Luciano, you have a workshop coming up, right? Oh, it's here. Yes. Where is that? There it is. So there's another workshop coming up. Is that here? Buenos Aires?
Yes.
Yeah. Perfect. So you need to go there because you need to learn.
Hay otro workshop que lo da Luciano, que está ahí. ¿Esa es de ahora o la que viene?
Okay.
Bueno, ahí en la página de TouchDesigner. ¿Quieren hacer alguna pregunta más?
And otherwise, have a look at the workshop videos and learn and teach resources on the education page, just for lots of videos and tutorials. All right, thanks.
Thank you.